Welcome everyone to this session. Thank you all for joining. I'm Alberto Rodriguez-Natal from Cisco, and I'm here with Marcel from Google. And in this session today, we wanted to talk with you about cloud-native and SD-WAN, and how SD-WAN and Kubernetes can deliver a better application experience if they talk a bit more with one another. So in the session today, we are going to start with an introduction of what is the current landscape of Kubernetes and SD-WAN, and why it may make sense for them to integrate a bit more. And then we're going to jump into the Cloud-Native SD-WAN open source initiative. This is an open source project we released this past summer around the time of KubeCon Europe. And in the talk today, we're going to go through the architecture. We're going to show you an example of how this thing falls together. And also, we are going to double click on each of the components. So we will end up with a Q&A, and we hope to have a bit of a discussion at the end with you guys. So with that, I will pass it to Mark that will kickstart the conversation.
Thank you, Alberto. So let's talk about why we're having this discussion in the first place. What is the intersection of Kubernetes and WANs? And in some ways, Kubernetes is a victim of its own success. So Kubernetes has become a very common layer to deploy applications. So applications have a consistent execution environment, no matter where they're running. And Kubernetes is available as a managed version in all the primary cloud providers. Customers are deploying them on-prem. And so there's many areas in which you can deploy an application on Kubernetes, including many regions and areas of the network around the world. And so while applications can be deployed in a really consistent way by using Kubernetes, the clusters themselves may be homogeneous areas for these applications, but the networks between them are not. And that is very much the problem that we're trying to address here, and a problem that I think many Kubernetes operators have, is you have applications that may be different applications, maybe the same instance, or maybe different instances of the same application across Kubernetes clusters that are in different cloud providers, different regions, have access across different types of networks. And then in addition to that, your users are in different areas, right? They are maybe enterprise work from home users. They're maybe enterprise from your branch. And so providing the connectivity between your Kubernetes hosted applications and your users is not an easy thing to solve. And this is very much what SD-WAN does. And so this presentation discusses how do we bring these two technologies together to help solve both of these problems and make the process of connecting to your Kubernetes hosted applications across wide area networks an easier thing to do. So let's talk a little bit about what SD-WAN actually solves in the first place. So software-defined WAN is a group of technologies offered by a lot of different companies that solve some of the challenges we have listed here. You have applications and endpoints across many different networks. You have users and clients across many different networks, and you have heterogeneous connectivity between them. And SD-WAN takes this heterogeneous connectivity, all these different types of network, and unifies them as a single controllable and programmable WAN fabric, so that your network operator now has a consistent view of the network. They have consistent control from a visibility perspective, a security perspective, and also a control and optimization perspective. And so this provides the kind of benefits that are really needed, especially as applications are deployed to multiple cloud providers, multiple regions, and across multiple different kinds of networks. And so now let's look at, okay, we have these two groups of technologies. How do we bring them together to kind of offer the competitive advantages and the complementary benefits that they each have? So in Kubernetes, you have different attributes of your application. We understand what the application is, what zone or region it is, the environment or provider, annotations that maybe dictate different attributes about the application. Of course, the IP and port where the application is accessible from, perhaps, you know, within that provider or maybe within the public internet, and also characteristics about the app like its health or how many replicas exist within the application. So those are things that are stored inside your Kubernetes cluster. And then SD-WAN has its own attributes that it understands its own picture of the world. It understands attributes of the user and the client and its identity and location. It understands attributes of the network path performance and health and what the connectivity looks like between the clients and your applications. And so when we're bringing these two things together, we're basically taking all these attributes and creating policy. And really, these attributes are important for different personas. And as you see, as we go through this presentation, you'll see that there are DevOps users or app or service owners that are deploying their applications in Kubernetes. And there are also NetOps users that are controlling the network and ensuring that there's a consistent, secure, and reliable network between users and applications. And if we have a policy-based infrastructure that's connecting these together, then we have a very nice and role-oriented way in which NetOps and DevOps can work together so that DevOps can have more control to determine the types of network policies that are applied to their applications. And then NetOps gets an understanding of how applications are being accessed and how clients are using them. And so this provides a lot of benefits. And over the next couple of slides, Alberto is going to show you some of the open source technologies that we're using to help users connect these two technologies together.
All right, thank you. Thank you, Mark. That was a fantastic introduction. So yes, as Mark said, let's spend some time now talking about open source and what we have done here. So this is about the Cloud-Native SD-WAN project. And the whole idea with the Cloud-Native SD-WAN project is that you have today SD-WAN and Kubernetes. And the two may be, you know, running together perfectly fine. And you have both DevOps and NetOps making sure that things look nice and fine on both ends. But there is little integration between the two, and you are missing some optimization opportunities. So the whole idea of the project is to, you know, take this picture that you have here and make it a bit more colorful. So for each of the different services that you may have running on your cluster, and this example is showing, for instance, a video conference application that is composed of different microservices that have different requirements from the network point of view, right? So the idea with the SD-WAN integration is to make SD-WAN a bit more aware of what's going on the application side, what's going on the Kubernetes side, so that it can provide optimizations specifically tailored for each of the microservices that the cluster is having. So with that, let's take a look at the architecture. So everything starts from the same picture we were looking at, the NetOps and the DevOps. So NetOps taking care of the SD-WAN controller and DevOps taking care of Kubernetes. And as probably all of you know, on the Kubernetes side, a lot of things start by deploying a YAML file, specifying your service. So the idea that SD-WAN introduces is that in that YAML specification, the DevOps can put a really simple annotation, and we'll take a look at the annotation later in the presentation. A very simple annotation that just specifies how the traffic for this particular service looks like. What, you know, is the kind of expectation that the service has on the one side of things. And that is something that then through the process that we're going to talk about right now, the SD-WAN can optimize for this particular type of service, for the traffic that this service is generating. So once you have this annotation on your YAML specification, there is a component that we call the SD-WAN operator that is running on the cluster and monitoring the services for this YAML annotation. And the moment it notices that one service has been annotated with this SD-WAN metadata, it passes the information to an external service registry. And today we support, for instance, Google Cloud Service Directory as service registry, but this in general can be any service registry. So once the information is available and, you know, easy to be consumed on the service registry, we have another component that we call the SD-WAN reader that is retrieving this information from the service registry. It's retrieving the name of the service with the IP and port, so it knows, you know, how the service is looks like from the external point of view, from the outside of the world of Kubernetes. And it's retrieving as well the metadata associated with this service so that it can then pass that information to a component we call the SD-WAN adapter. And the idea with the SD-WAN adapter is that this component is aware of how to interact with the SD-WAN controller. So you're going to have different SD-WAN adapters for each SD-WAN solution you are using. And the idea with the SD-WAN adapter is that the NetOps is going to configure two things. is going to configure first on the SD-WAN controller some policies, some, you know, SD-WAN policies as the NetOps can do today. And then it's also going to go to the CNWAN adapter and tell the CNWAN adapter, hey, look, I have these policies configured on my controller. I want you to map these policies to the information about the services you're receiving from Kubernetes. So that way, when a service is retrieved from the registry by the reader and pass it on to the adapter, the adapter knows by looking at the metadata of this service and looking at the mapping of policy to metadata that the NetOps did, which SD-WAN policy should apply to this service. So it can pass this information about the information about the service to the SD-WAN controller so that the SD-WAN controller can apply the proper policy for this service. So I know that this was maybe a bit too abstract and high level. So let's look at what this means in reality. So for that, I'm going to use this super simple example here that is kind of showcasing a very common SD-WAN deployment. So a typical enterprise may have multiple branches, maybe running some applications on the cloud, in Kubernetes, right? And this enterprise wants to have good connectivity between those branches and the application it is running on the cloud. So for that, it deploys an SD-WAN. And this is happening today already, and it's a common deployment mode. On the SD-WAN side of things, usually you tend to have multiple links over the network, so you can play with the different performance that you are serving on the different links and split the traffic between the links and so on. So in this particular example, we are showing an SD-WAN connection from branch to cloud that happens to go through an ISP network that offers two different types of connectivity, what we call in the picture public internet and business internet. Now you can imagine looking at the slide. So public internet is a best effort connectivity, very much what you can get at home, right? And it has maybe lower bandwidth, but also it costs less. So the enterprise decides to put most of the traffic through the public internet if possible. But then it also has what we call in this example business internet, a business internet connectivity that has higher bandwidth. It may have also as well less latency, lower latency, and so on. But the thing is that it comes at a higher cost. So if you want to use the business internet, you have to pay a bit. So that's why by default, any traffic going from the branch to the applications and coming back goes through the public internet because it's cheaper. But then you may have a particular service that requires more bandwidth, for instance. So and you want to deliver a good bandwidth for this service. Let's say, for instance, that you have a service that is a video streaming application running on the cluster. And then the NetOps has noticed that for video streaming, the public internet is not delivering good enough performance. So the NetOps has set up a policy on the network that says, okay, when you know that there is traffic for a particular video service, I want the SD-WAN to put that traffic on the business internet. So that's a policy that the NetOps may have set up on the SD-WAN fabric. And then the DevOps knows that it can use an annotation on the Kubernetes side using the CNWAN integration that is going to interact with these policies that the NetOps has provisioned. So the only thing the DevOps has to do is to, okay, annotate this service with a CNWAN annotation, and the NetOps and DevOps will coordinate on how those annotations look like. And by just deploying that annotation and through the integration we have described with the Cloud-Native SD-WAN project, the traffic automatically shifts and starts using the business internet. And this happened, under the scenes without any manual interaction on the NetOps or the top side. Just by the fact that you have this service with this particular annotation, the traffic is automatically put in the link that the NetOps knows is best for this particular type of traffic. So with that, let's double click on each of the components of the CNWAN solution. So I'm going to offer a bit of an overview of each of the components, and for you to don't get too lost, I'm trying to put a diagram at the top, pointing at which component we are looking at every moment. So right now we're looking at the CNWAN operator. This is the component that runs within the Kubernetes cluster. This is your typical Kubernetes controller that we have written in Golang, and we use Kubebuilder framework. And the idea with the SD-WAN operator, again, is to look for annotations on services. And you have an example of this annotation on the right. You see here, for instance, SD-WAN.io, traffic profile equals video. And this is a very good example of an annotation, and we use it as defaults in the, you know, the POCs that we do with this technology. But in general, this can be any kind of annotation. So as long as there is some understanding between the DevOps and NetOps on which is the kind of annotation expected, you can put anything that you think of, and then you can configure the SD-WAN operator to understand those annotations. So the SD-WAN operator, again, is going to register this information with the service registry. Today we support a World Cloud Service Directory, but we have some ongoing work to support DNS in general and also AWS Cloud Map. And we're making an effort to make the operator easy to install. So today we offer some scripts that, you know, sort of optimize most of the stuff using plain kubectl, but we have some ongoing efforts again to offer this through Operator Hub, and of course to offer the installation through Helm as well. And you have at the bottom the link to the code, so you can take a look for the service. So the second component, the SD-WAN reader, this guy is the one that is running, well, it can run anywhere, but it has to run closer to the SD-WAN control. It's closer to the SD-WAN deployment. So again, this is written on Golang again. And the idea with the SD-WAN reader is that it's monitoring the service registry, being it Web Service Directory today, or DNS or AWS Cloud Map, hopefully in the future. So any of those, monitoring the service registry for new services and annotations for those services. And the way it monitors those services, today we support gRPC polling towards Google Cloud Service Directory. We're also looking at some Kafka PubSub integration. And once it detects a new service or new information from the existing service and so on, it's passing that information to the adapter that, if you remember, is the guy that is closer to the SD-WAN controller. So the way the reader has to interact with the adapter is through what we call the SD-WAN Events API. That is an API that both the reader and the adapter have to implement. And we provide an open API schema on the GitHub repo, so you can take a look. So on the right, there is an example of how this API is used, right? So this example is showing a new observe service on the service registry that was annotated on the cluster with traffic profile equal video, for instance. This, you know, a plain example, depending on what you put on the cluster or how you configure the operator, you may see different metadata attributes here. But the idea is that the reader is going to pass this information to the adapter. So this example, let's say I've seen a new streaming service that was created. Here's the IPM port. So these are the IPM ports you can use to identify the traffic over the SD-WAN. And this is what the DevOps said about the service. The DevOps said, okay, the traffic profile for this service is video. So with that, we go to the SD-WAN adapter that is implementing the SD-WAN events API and taking care of this. Now, the interesting thing about the SD-WAN adapter is that it's specific per SD-WAN controller. So if you have a different SD-WAN solutions, you may need to use different adapters. So as of today, we only have one adapter that is for Viptela SD-WAN. And we are now starting to work on supporting also Meraki SD-WAN. So you can use any of those two. And any SD-WAN solution can have, again, its own adapter. And you know, the idea with SD-WAN is to be modular enough that anyone can write an adapter for the SD-WAN of choice. So since the only adapter that we have today is Viptela, that's the only one I can talk about, because there's nothing but ideas yet. So the way the Viptela adapter works is, first it's written in Python using the Viptela SDK. And the way it works is it offers a mappings API that basically maps the metadata that it got from the reader to a particular Viptela policy. So this is specific to Viptela, but if you look at the right side of this picture, you see, for instance, okay, metadata key, traffic profile with value video, I want you to map it in this particular policy. And then what we define for Viptela is policy type application web routing. This is a specific policy type on Viptela, so the SD-WAN solution will have different policy types. And then the NetOps in this example created a policy type of type application web routing that was named optimized video. And then the NetOps went to this and mappings API on the adapter to configure the mapping between traffic profile video on the Kubernetes side of the world with application aware routing optimized video on the Viptela side of the world. And in general, you know, the SD-WAN solutions may behave similarly, so you can have a similar model. And we hope that the adapter we provide now should serve as an example for supporting other SD-WANs in the future. So with that, we are at the end of the presentation, and we would like to have some Q&A with all of you. And before we jump into that, we would like to throw some questions already at the table. And these are things that we are asking ourselves, and we don't have answers yet, so we would like to see what you guys think. So one is, okay, can this model apply not only to WAN, but also to LAN, right? So what we have discussed so far is for SD-WAN connectivity or WAN connectivity in general. But if you think of it, nothing prevents Kubernetes from having a similar framework where you can specify requirements and you can specify, you know, the types of traffic and so on that a service has. And maybe a LAN network, a local area network, you know, your cloud network, your data center network, or whatever you have there, may also render specific optimizations for those services. So that takes us to the second question. Should Kubernetes have semantics in general for types of files? So we don't have answers for this. And we'll have to have a conversation with you guys. And you can see at the bottom the GitHub repo with all the code. We also have some documentation there. We have some nice automation that brings a small POC on Google Cloud today, so you can also try that. And also there is our email, so you can send us some notes there. And with that, we'll be happy to take any questions.